Good morning. Earlier on, we had a couple of discussions talking about DANE. So I'm just curious, how many of you in this room have heard of DANE before? Okay, so a good percentage. All right. And how many of you know what TLS SSL is? How it's implemented, how it works? Okay. So my presentation is sort of a lead up to the next session, which is where my colleague Jan Zos will be demonstrating just how he did some tests, in lab tests on the implementation of DANE. So this is sort of like just a warm-up discussion into what DANE is all about and how it actually works from a theoretical point of view. He will do the practical part of it. Okay. So basically, TLS is, we pretty much everybody calls it SSL. I actually didn't realize this until not too long ago that I knew TLS, but I thought TLS and SSL were different versions and implementations. But only to realize later that SSL is what evolved into TLS, and now we're in version 1.2 of TLS. And basically, this provides a transport layer security, which basically enables us to wrap around our communications between the client and server in an encrypted channel of communication, so that we prevent the man-in-the-middle attacks snooping into the conversations that we are having between the client and the server. So initially, the historical background too of SSL was that it was developed by Netscape to try and secure the communication between the end user and the server. And this has evolved now that it is now currently implemented across multiple protocols and multiple applications. And one of the things which I found interesting was that in the last a couple of years back, when I was actively involved in running networks, we had this process where many ISPs preferred to build their own mail servers. And they would build mail servers using open source solutions, Squirrel Mail, Open Web Mail, etc., etc. But the one thing which they really never used to do is implement SSL or TLS for that matter. And so a lot of users, and I still see this today in my country, in Kenya, where there are quite a number of corporates that provide, I'll say enterprise solutions based out of open source applications, Squirrel Mail, etc. But everything is still going through plane of non-secure communication, so there's no SSL. And some people, in some instances, when they've smartened up enough, they will do self-signed certificates, and this works. But again, there's a process of where if you move from your laptop to a cyber cafe or somewhere else, the process of getting through to get into the website in a secure way means you have to accept the certificate. And so depending on which browser you're using, the process may either be simple, straightforward, or a user ends up calling customer service or customer support to say, I'm having a problem, I cannot log in. So that experience is still there. It's still a challenge. I still see many applications that not just webmail implementations. We have many people in this day and age who still support POP3, for instance, access to mail servers that don't do POP3 yet. I don't know how many of you use POP3. How many people use POP3? Is it POP3S or just POP3? POP3, no S. Aha. So,
IMAP
S. Sorry?
The
So that's pretty much what we see happening, that the implementation of the security aspect on these other protocols. On the web server, as on the web front, on the browser, that seems to have moved a lot faster than you see on mail systems, and I'm not sure why. SMTP, how many people do SMTP, secure SMTP? How many don't? I see a few hands up. So it means that this, and the implementation of TLS and SSL on most of these protocols, SMTP, IMAP, POP3, they're well developed. They're very well used, very well implemented. And, you have a few problems depending on certain implementations, but largely works really, really well. It's been a long time since I actually had problems with the implementation of TLS on most of these protocols. And on VoIP, I don't know whether anybody's doing VoIP, how many do VoIP on with SSL, TLS? No. Here's another one which I like. Java, chat. How many of you do chat using Java? Java? Any other chat, IRC? Job is the only one on IRC here. So, and how many of you use that with TLS SSL? So, the support does exist, but the implementations have taken a while to actually be put in place. And, I mean, the benefits are all there. We all know why it is important. It's just that the uptake tends to be slow. And part of the reason is, A, for it to work seamlessly, you need to implement, go and get a certificate. And going to the CAs means it's a cost. You have to go and buy, pay for the certificate, to pay the certificate authority for you to get, a publicly signed certificate from a public CA. If you do a self-signing, then you have to do the workarounds, which means people need to have a way of getting your key or your public certificate onto their root keys so that can work. So it leaves a couple of things broken. I mean, I remember for some time I was working at the Kenyan CCTLD, and a couple of things we had to do was for the registrars to come into the system and register domain names, they had to log into a secure page. But it was very difficult for me to convince my board that we needed to pay a certificate authority for us to have assigned CA with a public CA by a public certificate authority. So for a long time, I used a self-signed certificate. And so I had to tell the registrar, well, just, this is our public key, just add it to the machines, the browser that we've been using to access, and life will be easy. But then on some of the local mailing lists, somebody over time, and this is after I'd left, used to complain, why is it that the CCTLD does not have a signed certificate by a public CA? And it became an issue of discussion until they had to go on that. So, or pay for one a signed certificate. So, that process makes it somewhat difficult for some people to actually implement TLS. So, and to a certain extent, it also means that you're leaving it to the application to be responsible for, checking that the site, that it's, it's going to check that the site matches the name, and that it also trusts the CA who signed the certificate. And I think in the previous, just before we went for coffee break, there was the discussion about CAs that were compromised that actually went down. there's been compromised on our CAs that we've seen, I think it was in 2013, by I think it was a Turkish CA or delegated CA who accidentally signed a Google certificate. You know, there was rather a falsely signed Google certificate. So there was another Google certificate and a Microsoft certificate out there that was not actually part of a valid one, or rather, I would like to say a credible one, but it was false. So because the CAs do delegation to sub, I'm trying to, what's the name, intermediary, the intermediary or certificate authorities, so that there are thousands of them, and they are the ones who also just have just as much powers as the CAs themselves to sign certificates, then it becomes very difficult at that point, because that intermediary CA can actually, you know, they can make a mistake, and once they make that mistake can be propagated, and to fix it, it's not something that you can fix overnight. It takes, once that goes into the browsers, it's out there, then, you know, the issue of Google in 2013 took a week or more for the revocations to happen, for the updates on the browsers to be sent on Google, Chrome, on Firefox, and all the others. So it takes a while. And so during that period, it means that particular domain is exposed, you know, because not all users are conscious of the implications. There was another case where in-flight, and this was discovered by a Google staff who was on a flight. This is the Google in-flight service in the US. And they realized that there was a proxy in between that was actually also basically issuing false certificates. And you could only notice this by checking and validating. If you're non-technical and are not conscious, you will not know that you are actually getting a false certificate from the Google service. And so, and this was just discovered by Google staff on flight, realized, oh, wait a minute, the certificate I have is not valid from, and they were going to a, I think, YouTube service or something like that. And, you know, Google issued this, a press release after that saying that the reason why they do that is to make sure that some of the, to try and protect the quality of service that they provide, because they limit, or rather they try and restrict people going to high bandwidth sites like Google, YouTube, etc. So they will try and basically serve as a man in the middle so that they check where you're going, what content you're going to access, because if you're using an encrypted service, you know, you could be doing anything, including going to sites where, you know, you're using a lot more bandwidth and constraining other users on that service. So their response to me was like, okay, so you want to really, you know, intercept my secure communications just to ensure that I'm not using, you know, I'm maintaining my fair use policy. But what more then can you do in that process? So it left me asking more questions than the answers that I was able to get from the response. So there are various many solutions that are coming up as a result of, there are too many CAs, there are quite a number of incidents that have happened. The implementation of TLS SSL still remains wanting in some of the other protocols. So DANE is one of those areas where I think, in my view, is providing what I would say credible use, credible use of the TLS protocols and DNSSEC. So, if you look at the diagram I have here, the way TLS works is that the resolver and the client, in this case, the client being the person who is browsing to our website, the client PC will go to a DNS resolver, then do the normal query of DNS. Once you get, the client receives an IP address, at that point is when the TLS SSL negotiation is going to take place. And when it takes place at that point, the information that is sent back to the server is basically where the security starts. The TLS will only be encrypted only after you've had the IP address, which means that the IP you got at this point was a separate process, which is DNS. And then once you connect to the server based on the IP you've been given, is the only time you start the secure communication. So the validation process of whether that IP is correct first is entirely dependent on DNS and DNSSEC. And then on this other end, you have the web server telling you whether it's the actual server you're going to or not, based on the negotiation that takes place and your ability to verify the information you're receiving from the server using the certificate authority, the CA information that you have on your browser. So there's no way of matching these two to validate both processes. But DANE now allows us to be able to do this when basically the DNS server gives you more information, not just the IP address, but it also tells you, oh, and once you get to that host, you should expect a certificate, and this is what the certificate should be. So at that point, when you go to the server and the server gives you a certificate, you can be able to check and see, is this valid? Yes. If it's not valid, then you have a choice to either accept it or not accept it. And that means if there's someone in between, whether it's a firewall, a man in the middle attack, who is rewriting that, then in the absence of DANE, everything can be rewritten, okay? And this just shows the example I was talking about where the Google stuff, the Google in-flight service. You'll get some a green on HTTPS saying that it's okay, but in between there was a firewall or there was a proxy that actually was able to rewrite the certificate. So you'll get everything looking fine. But in DANE, if you're using DANE, DANE will tell you, sorry, that certificate that you got right there in the middle was modified. It's not the actual one. So basically, DANE, what DANE is, and I think we haven't even defined DANE before, is DNS-based authentication of named entities. So what it does is that it enables you to use the DNS infrastructure to host information about the certificates that you have on your applications. So that means your TLS or SSL certificates. So you can store the certificate or a fingerprint of that on the DNS using the DANE resource record, which is called TLSA, and then have that signed using DNSSEC. Now, we all know the benefits of DNSSEC. I think the last two presentations we've had before Coffee Break, the one by Simon, been talking about DNSSEC. So there's already a very robust, what I see to be a very robust system of securing the DNS using DNSSEC, which means there's a single transfer anchor, which is the root, and the process of how DNS works from the validation to the, from the trust anchor, that is the root, all the way to the delegation, the delegated zones, is very robust and well thought through. And having a hash or part of, or the certificate actually, or the certificate or a hash of the certificate inside the DNS means that you, for you as an end user, you already have certain parts of information that you can go in to verify before going to the website, that this website that I've gone to, or the machine that is responding to me based on the IP that I've used to go to get to it, is the one that's actually supposed to be serving me the information that I'm looking for. So, a little bit more about DANE. So DANE, there's an RFC that defines how DANE works. That's RFC 6698. The resource record value is known as TLSA. There's really not much about the resource record in terms of, you know, just any other resource record you have, like in DNS. There are other resource records that actually have similar characteristics. One of the things which I just thought was interesting was that there is no special TTL requirements, unlike in other resource records. It has four particular fields, and there's a reason I thought presenting this will be useful. So there are four fields: the certificate usage, the selector, the matching type, and the certificate association data. And each one of them has a key role that it plays. So the first one is the certificate usage, which is a one octet value, has a one octet value. And it sort of defines the four different modes of operations of DANE. The first one is the CS specification, basically, which specifies which certificate authority will provide the TLS certificate for that particular domain. So if you set the value as zero, it means you have a, you're defining or restricting to a specific CA. Then value one means you're specifying or restricting to a specific certificate. So only that certificate which is signed by, issued by a valid CA is going to be accepted. And then you have option two, which means that you're defining who, or defining where the trust anchor will be. And in this case, you can define an alternative trust anchor, which is not included as part of the CA, which is not part of the well-known CAs. And then you have option three, which is a domain issued certificate or end entity. So if you're an organization like my former CCTLD, and we didn't have a budget for having a CA signed certificate, what we will do is use option three, where we create our own certificate, sign it, and use that as the option on the TLSA. Then we have the TLSA selector field. Basically, this defines or specifies which part of the TLS certificate is going to be presented by the server. So you have an option. You can either provide inside the DNS resource record, you can provide the full certificate, or just the subject public key information section. And in this part, basically, you have the option of using either or. Then the matching type. So first you have the options. So let me just go through this again. So the first part is the usage selector field, which if you look at the three, the four fields. So the certificate usage, the selector, the matching type, and then the certificate association data. So we've seen the certificate usage has those four options for DANE. Then the selector is what part of the certificate. Is it the full certificate, or is it either the full certificate or the subject public key information? And then the matching type, you're sort of saying, what exactly are you going to find there? Are you going to get the full or a hash? So this determines of that certificate, either the full certificate or the subject public key information, is it going to be the full information or a hash of that part which is you provided from the selected information. And then that the remaining data, either the hash or the full certificate, will now be stored under the certificate association data. And I'll show you in an example later on how that looks like. Okay. And it also provides an option when you're doing the matching type to define whether you're using a SHA-256 or a SHA-512 the hash is either a SHA-256 or SHA-512. All right, so I've talked about the certificate data fields. And so here's an example of how the resource record will look like in your DNS. So one of the things that it does on DNS is the resource record is defined by the first part, which is the application port, what port it's running on. So in this particular case, this is 443 for SSL, HTTPS rather, and then the protocol type, in this case TCP, the transport protocol, and then we have the domain or the host name that is going to be hosting there to go and get the resource, the site in this case. And then, so we have the user certificate. So it's a normal resource record. You have to define the TLSA record type in the DNS in terms of what resource record it is for. And then you have the usage, certificate usage. Then you have the selector value, and then you have the match type. So in this case, it's 001. And then you have the full certificate in the R data part of it. So that's basically how the resource record will look for the TLSA in your DNS. So it's not that complicated. And you know, for those who would like to do this manually, it's possible to do it. Probably we'll get some getting used to, but there are other solutions that exist to simplify that. So, DANE is not just for HTTPS. This can be done for email. It can be done for VoIP, Java, and PGP. There are quite a number of uses out there so far. So there are some success stories. There are over 360 SMTP servers with TLSA records. Actually, 400. There are 401. I think I sent the wrong presentation. I was checking yesterday, and there are over 400 SMTP servers with TLSA records. Java servers out there. Now, some of the things which I found interesting was that the implementation with SMTP is interesting. I was looking at PostFix, and when you look at how the implementation takes place with PostFix, you will see that they are not happy with the specifications that have been asked, provided in here. So there's a little bit of lack of clarity in the usage mode operations for DANE. So PostFix, for instance, will, if you define the CS specification, that's option zero, PostFix will ignore. If you use one, option one, where the TLS is defined, PostFix will assume, will treat it as three. If you use two, which is defining a trust anchor assertion, then that works. But if you use zero, it will ignore. If you use one, it will assume one is the same as three. So It's still pretty much for them in the early stages of implementation. There's quite a bit of learning going on. But that, despite that, I mean, we've seen that there are quite a number of people who've gone out there and started implementing, implementing DANE on their mail servers. So we have over 400 mail servers out there with TLSA records. There's a website which you can actually go, tlsa.info, to check for testing. And the good thing is the uptake is growing. I mean, I was quite impressed to see that there's a hosting service provider, Flex Secure Hosting, who are actually advertising that they provide DANE, DNSSEC, and DANE services. So, you know, I mean, if I was conscious and critical about security, I would definitely go for this kind of service provider. Of course, you can definitely use DANE at this point in time for most of your services. If you know, that's something that is of importance to you. I think the DANE service provides the most valuable way of actually getting or reassuring your customers. It actually enhances security for the customers who actually are security conscious at this point in time. But even going forward, I think this will serve as an anchor of getting more people, getting more DNSSEC signed, more zones signed, more TLDs signed, because this is a practical use, in my view. This provides practical use of DNSSEC. So the three steps of getting DANE is first, you know, implement TLS on your application and service, publish TLSA records, the format as I've explained earlier, and then, you know, there are tools out there like hashing, which is used to help generate records, and then sign your domain name with DANE. So for the applications, you have to have access to a DNS validating resolver. I think that has been talked about previously. And then try to make sure that your DNS application library supports DNSSEC. There are a couple which are out there. You can get to see, I think Unbound has released a library that can be used, which is DNSSEC aware. So that can help support the applications, so that the application is able to get the information from the DNSSEC servers. So in conclusion, there are quite a number of resources we have available with respect to DANE, the Deploy 360 website. There's quite a lot of useful materials on there to look at. There have been a couple of blogs which have been written. The IETF journal also publishes some information on DNSSEC DANE. And what's going on that in the discussion of the IETF. So, and of course, the RFCs will always be a good place to go and read about DANE. This presentation will be online, so please have a look at these DANE resources. They're very useful for anyone who will be interested in deploying. And there's a team from ISOC here who will be Ramzos, Megan, Andre, myself. We can talk to you about more on DANE implementation. I think just to conclude, the reasons for deploying DANE is that the four key things which we really need to make sure are supported is that there's trust on the internet, that we continue to maintain trust, the security is enhanced, we support innovation, because if you look at it from the point of view that DANE is built on existing DNSSEC and TLS infrastructure or services. So for the internet to continue evolution, then we need to make sure that trust and security is increased or enhanced. And of course, supporting confidentiality of the users. So there's quite a lot going on. We'll be definitely happy to have a chat about DANE later. I think I'll stop here. pretty much done more than my 30 minutes. If there are any questions, happy to take them.
Any questions?
If you look at this whole design, it depends on the fact that the application gets the proper DANE TLSA record. Is that correct?
Yes.
So now going back to the Google example, I can then insert my own DNS server that will answer to the application back to the TLSA record that I want him to see. So then where's the security in that?
Okay. Only works.
But the DNSSEC, is the DNSSEC then from the application testing that, or is the DNSSEC, is the application depending on the resolver for its security?
Yes.
So if I have a resolver that is not answering DNS, that basically compromised, I can then give you back compromised answers on the DNSSEC side.
Well,
no, but that's the thing that I'm saying that in the Google example, the firewall, the environment there is control. So they have control over the DNS server, the resolver, they have control over the firewall. Both of those can then give you the answer that they want you to see, and that way you bypass any of the DNS security. Unless you have an application that talks directly DNSSEC to the roots, for example, to be able to pick that up.
Okay, I get your point. So that's a very interesting. Joe, do you want to comment on that?
Hi there. So the thing is that this middle box, X509 normal SSL should protect you from a middle box. And it doesn't in the GoGo example because your browser has sometimes 500 to 800 different trust anchors that have been packaged with it, none of which you've reviewed personally, and some of which have issued CAs, which people like GoGo make in middle boxes can then use to regenerate certificates, which don't cause a browser warning. So the basic point you were making that, you know, if GoGo is also running the resolver, then they could also just send back smooth TLSA records. The answer there is don't rely on the resolver to do your validation. If you're doing DANE, you really need to be doing validation in the browser, which means the conventional resolver component, the validate component, needs to be in the application in the browser, rather than upstream where you just rely on an unsigned bit to tell you whether it's secure or not.
So then you have to implement your resolver inside your browser.
Right, which is in practice what all these applications are doing. They're doing the validation in the application because you can't depend on an untrusted resource off the box to be able to give you secure answers. Well, you can still use the upstream resolver as a source of answers. The difference is you don't ask the validation to happen there. You set the CD bit. You say, check disabled. You receive all the DNSSEC information yourself, and you make your own decision, rather than outsourcing the decision for the validator, which runs on a different machine.
That means that it's coming from the resolver.
Well, if you could trust the data coming from the resolver, you wouldn't need DNSSEC. So you assume that the data is coming, needs to be checked, it is untrustworthy. So the end result is you don't guarantee that the user will get the accurate results. What you're providing is a mechanism where the end user can tell when the results are not authentic. So instead of giving the nice green happy bar that says, yes, this is all secure, you can give something that says warning. It looks like the answer that we got from the DNS or the certificate that we checked is invalid. Do you want to continue? And some browsers are more aggressive at stopping users continuing than others. So you always assume, like I say, if you never had to worry about the fact that you're going to be served non-authentic data, you wouldn't need any security. So you have to assume that the data is not authentic and have to do very paranoid checks. And that's what the stuff is doing.
For this, I think NICCZ has developed the DNSSEC and TLSA validator for Chrome, Firefox, Apple, I think, Safari. So you have to install it as a plugin into the browser for you to validate that. And it also gives you the option to set which resolver you would want, for instance, to use, which is outside of the one that is the default for your computer. You can actually use a different resolver as well.
I will do some work here. Please correct me if I'm wrong. My understanding is that your browser is going to be resolving itself, which kind of messes up with if things like YouTube, all those CDN content providers, they use your the DNS resolver to know where to send things back to. If something that the user's browser doesn't give you that DNS lookup, won't that mess with that traffic flow?
So it's the validation. What you're saying is
what you call like your appliance as a standard or just to comment on a lot of the CDNs. There is kind of a myth out there that it is all about the resolving with your user. Now, my understanding, particularly with the YouTube stuff, if you're announcing your user's blocks to your GGC and the recursor and the requests are coming from that user block, they'll still map to the GGC. In the case of someone like Akamai, etc., it goes way, way beyond the DNS resolver. It becomes latency metrics, it becomes a million other metrics. So I don't think that's going to have that much of an effect. I've seen people using our recursors that definitely do not end up hitting our CDN nodes because of the other metrics imposed. So I don't think that's going to have an effect.
So just one more little bit on that. I work for DANE, and we're actually in the business of mapping the outbound addresses that we see from recursives at the authority server to particular content for customers like Twitter. And we pay a lot of attention to the outbound address that we see from the recursive server. Or we look at signaling that comes through the query in the DNS options, so we get some recursors sent through the source address of the actual client as an EDNS0 client subnet option, which gives us a better approximation to where the client actually comes from. And Google is one of the big people who do this, which is good, because a lot of people use Google from countries that are not local to the resolver. Mm-hmm. I think most of Vietnam uses Google as a resolver, and there's no Google infrastructure in Vietnam, so that's interesting. But in fact, if you pull the source of the DNS query back to the actual user, instead of pushing it through a resolver, that makes our job easier. It's much easier to identify the end user, and therefore it's much easier to give them an answer which steers them towards local content. Because normally it's an approximation. We see traffic from a particular resolver, and we infer where the client is, but we don't have to do that inference if we get the query straight from the user.
I think to answer your point, more specifically, it's the validation that's being done from your application, not the query, or not the lookup going to a non-default source.
Okay. You still remember what I wanted to ask?
Yeah. No, I don't document. I can have my own resolver inside my machine, my local machine. I can install any stick trigger of any LLAP. It will be better if you want to have your local DNS resolver.
Yes, I mean, and that's there. You can actually have your own resolver. The question that was being asked earlier is when a lot of this is controlled. So if you're in a Google Flight service, they will capture your TCP and UDP DNS port traffic and redirect it to a local DNS server. And that's where the capture comes in. And that's I think, the question that was being asked is, how do you control if you're locked onto a network which is listening and taking your port 53 UDP TCP traffic and redirecting it internally. And the same thing for the SSL traffic. And so you're likely to get back information that, you know, is modified to, and your browser is likely to trust that. But if you're able to do your own validation and say, you know, this is what I expect, then if it doesn't match, then you can actually be in a position to say, you know, the browser will be able to notify you that this is actually modified information and it's not accurate.
Good morning. If your certificate, you need to apply a new certificate, do you just have multiple TLS records then, or how do you make provision to roll out a new certificate? Like with the DNS set stuff, we said that you can actually just do a 6-month period on your record, or how do you do in that instance?
So, one of the things which I have seen some examples on, and you probably have done more practical on this, is people use like a CNIN, which refers to multiple, so you have your SSL or rather a host which is doing SSL, let's say 443 for SSL or HTTPS. There's a host for that. It CNINs to a host which keeps all the information. So you're, instead of creating multiple certificates, you're only referring to one particular certificate for the different services that you have. I don't know whether that answers the question. No? Okay.
To answer that question, yes, but make your TLS, your time to live, make it small before you're going to do a rollover. Are you allowed to have multiple TLSAs? Yeah, multiple TLSAs, and they can be pointing to certificates that don't exist. That's fine. So when you get the new certificate, you obviously can only show one certificate at a time. Put the new certificate in. If you can try and pre-publish a new TLS fake with a new certificate and work it that way. No problem.
Okay, I think we're done with questions. Thank you, Chief.